He stood out because of his sense of humor and audacity.
Always right on the edge of going too far.
They chased one goal relentlessly.
Bryant was a very determined individual, very smart.
He wanted to see how far he could take it.
If it repulsed you, that was just as good as if it made you happy.
Through struggles.
I think what led to him becoming Marilyn Manson was probably Heritage Christian School.
And setbacks.
Everybody hated us. Nobody wanted to sign us.
Some people are just driven.
Someday I want to grow up to be a rock star.
A quiet kid who didn't fit in reinvents himself as America's most feared shock rocker.
He was just a normal, sweet child.
I'm gonna punch you in the f***ing teeth.
There would be nudity.
Girls in cages.
You know, he cut himself open pretty good sometimes.
Never before seen images, stories, and revelations from the people who know what really happened, because they lived it with him.
We were like bisexual, satanic drug addicts.
People are getting totally the wrong message here about Brian.
This is Driven, Marilyn Manson.
Born in January of 1969. He was a very quiet little boy, a lot like his mother. I think he looks a lot like his father, but I see a lot of his mother's shyness in him. He was the type of child that if he walked into a room and there were a lot of people, he would hide behind his mother and then slowly come out. So if someone had said to me that one of these children is going to be a famous rock star, Brian would have been the last one I would have chosen.
Ladies and gentlemen, Marilyn Manson!
He grew up in Canton, Ohio.
It's in the Midwest, so it's a fairly conservative town.
Canton's kind of a boring little town. There's not a whole lot. Football is big.
We have the Pro Football Hall of Fame.
That's our big claim to fame.
When I first met Brian, he was pretty small. He kind of freckly-faced kid, brown hair, pretty scrawny.
I know he got made fun of a lot. I guess he was what they call a nerd.
Brian and I played midget league football in 1981 for the Spartans. I was number 28, Brian was number 41. Brian was a receiver. As a receiver, you wouldn't get much action.
He never really liked this whole sports thing.
Brian didn't really have a lot of friends. He wouldn't leave the house all too often. He stayed home a lot, watched TV, would draw, would write.
His grandpa and grandmother on his mother's side lived right next door to him in the duplex, so he got a lot of attention from his family.
He was an only child.
So he got pretty much whatever he wanted.
Brian's mom was very sweet, very wonderful, excellent mother, little of June, you know, Cleaver there, but hipper.
He was raised on, you know, cartoons and cereal and Coca-Cola, the Smurfs.
Brian's main motivations were probably just entertainment.
We used to create these characters out of clay, but we'd put all the body parts inside. And our big project then is to operate on them and take all the organs out and change them. And that was a big one for a while.
Brian had a very active imagination.
It's basic kid stuff that, you know, we'd be fascinated with, like, you know, burps, you know, any kind of, you know, bowel movements, anything to that effect.
I remember him telling me that he really liked eating Superman ice cream. It had, I guess that kind of ice cream had a lot of different colors in it or something, because he said when he went to the bathroom, everything came out purple, and he just thought that was pretty cool.
Brian started Heritage Christian in second grade, and he went through the 10th grade.
It was a typical parochial school. It was private.
And the school was very right-wing conservative, had a lot of Baptist upbringing and teachings. We had Bible class once a day, and then weekly we had chapel.
It would bring in different speakers or some local ministers or something.
Definitely was a lot of fear factor, was definitely held fire and brimstone.
The speakers were pretty much targeted to try and convince us of, like, the evil ways of the outside world. There was a lot of evangelical-type language. Come down front. Stand up in front of your peers and show them you're not afraid. Brian has such a thirst for knowledge. He stood out because of his sense of humor and because of his audacity at times. A few times when he would try to participate, bring up a topic in class, he just gets shot down immediately. And I could tell that really bothered him.
Brian definitely likes to push people's buttons. He's witty and fun, but always right on the edge of going too far.
in his Bible study class, he'd share with me that he'd write 666 and things like that on the books. It's not like he worshiped the devil, but he'd write things on there just to get a rise out of those teachers. And it worked. He'd get reprimanded for it.
Well, we were really into Mad Magazine and Cracked Magazine because we loved that sense of humor. And so we decided to do our own magazine and sell it to kids at school who didn't have much access to that kind of stuff. And by the end of the day, he had been called into the principal's office, gotten spanked. He'd never second-guess himself, just incredibly driven as far as if there's something he wants to do, he goes after it.
Brian was never into anything halfway. He pushes everything he can to the limit. Dungeons & Dragons was definitely Brian's biggest interest.
Everything about Dungeons & Dragons we had to know and devour.
We spent, maybe like a week straight one time playing. I mean, we took breaks to go home and go to sleep and eat meals, and we'd come back first thing in the morning and start playing again. His parents, bought him hundreds and hundreds of pewter miniatures, and he would hand paint all of those. He was so creative when we would play. He would always add some spin to it above and beyond what the rules were in the book.
We started to get rhetoric coming out of some of the teachers and in chapel about how Dungeons & Dragons could lead to all sorts of depravity. And so that's when there was a really sharp clampdown on some of the activities that the students were doing.
We actually had to sign a contract, an agreement, that we wouldn't drink, we wouldn't do drugs, we wouldn't cuss, we wouldn't listen to rock and roll music. And they spent an awful lot of time trying to teach the kids not about religion, but instead about why rock music is going to rot your brain.
Yeah, Brian liked hard rock music, so right away he was the devil.
We listened to a lot of the larger-than-life bands at that time, Ozzy Osbourne, Black Sabbath, and Judas Priest. He was a huge Kiss fan. His father and mother took him to concerts even. His dad even got dressed up with him a few times in all the makeup. He had every Kiss record, every Kiss makeup kit, radio, you name it.
Brian would be painting his face up like the members of Kiss and come to the house, and then he'd ask for himself. And we thought that he was one of the members of KISS asking for him, like he was really important. He'd have the little blood capsule in his mouth and he'd break it, and he was really into that kind of thing.
He seemed to draw energy from the dark side of the music.
He drew an Iron Maiden album cover on the concrete wall in chalk.
He had that above his bed. He had this big drawing there, this picture of this creature thing.
He's a good artist. It was very detailed.
It was creepy.
Brian was so big on MTV when it first came out. He was the first kid on the block that had it.
And I remember in particular a video of David Bowie's Ashes to Ashes that really had an effect on Brian. The atmosphere and sensibility of it just really piqued a curiosity that, wow, we don't have to sit around the table with Dungeons & Dragons and our imaginations. We can actually create these things visually. It was just fascinating. In about the eighth or ninth grade, we're getting more and more into our own imaginations, even more isolated from the people around us. They were all making decisions to make religion and Christianity a big part of their lives.
If you wore your Bible on your sleeve, you got great grades. In this very restricted place, you were better off to kind of fake your existence than you were to show your real existence.
Once he became aware that people were offended by a lot of the things he was interested in, it became more of a challenge.
Brian tended to lash out against the hypocrisy that he saw there at the school.
Our major goal at that time then was to find ways to get out of there.
Coming up, Brian escapes from Heritage Christian, but his social nightmare continues in public school.
I think Brian had a lot of trouble relating to the other kids because I think he was more intelligent.
And later, a gig as a rock journalist fuels his appetite for music stardom.
When he did an interview with Trent Reznor of Nine Inch Nails, his ultimate dream was to be Trent Reznor.
But in his first performance, Marilyn succeeds only in scaring himself.
He definitely had some major stage fright, and half the time he'd be in the back throwing up.
He didn't fit in with Wild Heritage Christian School.
I remember him many times talking to his parents, like wanting to go to public school. I have to get out of there.